Okay, thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. And I would like first to thank the organization committee and the SRLF for inviting me for this presentation. I'm going to talk about prolonged CPR and especially to try to select for which patient it could be beneficial. Yeah, my conflict, I don't have any conflict related to this presentation. I received some travel fees. So first, we should try to define what is prolonged CPR, because there is no clear definition for a recommended CPR duration. In the 2015 guidelines, there is only one information about the duration of CPR, and it's in the termination of resuscitation part. And it says that if you have an asystole for more than 20 minutes, despite ongoing advanced life support, in the absence of a reversible cause, you can probably stop CPR. In refractory cardiac arrest studies, the definition is not always defined. And when it's defined, it's usually 30 minutes of CPR before going to refractory cardiac arrest. So for which patient should we do more? In this study published last year in Circulation, they analyzed the association between duration of resuscitation and favorable outcome. You can see in this first graph that the cumulative proportion of patients achieving ROSC is almost 100% after 30 minutes of CPR duration. For the probability of good neurologic outcome, there is a clear difference between shockable and non-shockable rhythm. And as you can see, in shockable rhythm, you don't have good neurologic outcome after 15 minutes of CPR, usually. And it's very different in shockable rhythm, where you can have survive with good neurologic outcome for much longer time. For other parameters, you have the same differences between witnessed and unwitnessed cardiac arrest. And the difference is less important between bystander CPR and non-bystander CPR. In this other study, the results are almost the same. It's from a Japanese group, and the duration of CPR to get a ROSC is around a maximum of 40 minutes. And their conclusion is that resuscitation effort should be continued for at least 40 minutes from call receipt or 33 minutes after EMS responder resuscitation effort on scene. So for which patient we should or even we must do it. There are several case reports on observational series of the beneficial effect of prolonged CPR and after extracorporeal CPR for hypothermic patient. So this is an example for a patient in our area, published in Critical Care Medicine. So it was a 57 years old woman lost in a snowstorm at 2,000 meters of altitude. The emergency call was received at 4:43 p.m. in the afternoon. The rescue team was on scene almost 4 hours after the call, so the weather was pretty bad. She felt unconscious 25 minutes before rescue team arrival. Her carotid pulse was 6 per minute. She had no breathing. And then, despite cautious tried for extrication, the patient went to VF at 8:40 p.m. She received 3 shocks, 1 milligram of adrenaline, and she didn't get a ROSC. So they decided to move the patient to the hospital. And it was difficult to move the patient. So they walked for 1 minute, performed 1 minute of CPR, walked 1 minute, 1 minute of CPR. And the road was reached at 10:30 p.m. The mechanical CPR was available only for the last hour of transportation. The patient arrived at the hospital at 1:10 a.m., so almost 4 hours after the arrest, and the temperature was 16.9 degrees Celsius. You can see that the kaliemia was not very high, 5.8. So we can say that this is prolonged CPR, and ECPR with rewarming was established at 1:47 a.m., so 5 hours after the arrest. She gets spontaneous cardiac activity at 3:08. Targeted temperature management was initiated, and the patient at 3 months had a good neurological recovery with a mild cognitive impairment with just short-term and alteration of executive function. So this is a good example of a good indication of a prolonged CPR. In a paper, a review of our case of severe accidental hypothermia in the French Alps, we found a clear difference between a rescue collapse and unwitnessed cardiac arrest. So a rescue collapse is a cardiac arrest in front of the rescue team during extrication or during transportation. And the survival is very different between those two cases. In the rescue collapse group, all of the patients had good neurologic outcome, and in the unwitnessed cardiac arrest groups, there was no patient with good neurologic outcome. And the total CPR time for those patients was 80 minutes in median. So for which patient we should or we must do it? Probably for accidental hypothermia, especially if in case of rescue collapse. If there is sign of life during CPR, also there is not a lot of data available about that, but it's kind of obvious that if you have sign of life during CPR, you should continue CPR. And in some case of intoxication. For which patient, the evidence are less clear, but it should be probably beneficial for some other patient. And in a review that we that was recently accepted in Resuscitation, we try to look at prognostic factor for extracorporeal CPR and therefore for prolonged CPR, because usually to get extracorporeal CPR, you need to have prolonged CPR before. So there was four prognostic factors that were significantly associated with a good outcome. First, it was initial chokeable rhythm. The low flow duration was also significant. And at hospital admission, the lactate and pH level were also significantly associated with better outcome. The lower is better, that's for lactate and inversely for pH. And this is an example of a protocol for selected patient for extracorporeal CPR in Minnesota. So it's in Minneapolis. So they took patients between 18 to 75 years old with only refractory VF or VT. Patient got mechanical CPR. And at hospital arrival, they have other criteria to select the patient before implantation of the extracorporeal CPR. So patient must have two of the three of follow, end-tidal CO2 more than 10 millimeters of mercury, PaO2 more than 50 millimeters of mercury, and lactate under 18. After that, they put the ECMO, and if a reversible cause is identified, they pursue the ECMO. If not, they just let the ECMO for 60 minutes and see how it goes for the patient. And if the patient didn't get a ROSC, they stop at that point. And with that protocol, so it's preliminary result, they have 27 patients transported by EMS, 18 patients with inclusion criteria, and 53% of survival, and 50% of survival with good neurologic outcome. Patients are sick, that's they have high lactate level, they have so prolonged CPR by standard CPR of, it was around 60 minutes, I can find it. And the troponin level was high also during the time course of hospitalization. So for which patient, we should probably do it, and the evidence is less clear, but probably for refractory VF or VT, probably if there is a ROSC at any time during CPR, so recurrent cardiac arrest. If the low flow duration is short, ideally less than 60 minutes, but maybe 80, maybe 100 minutes, you can have some survival. If you have a high end-tidal CO2 during CPR, if the lactate and pH level at admission could help also, and if it's a reversible cause. The last group, it's we should probably not do it for this patient. So there are several studies that try to find some termination criteria to be accurate in the termination of resuscitation for those patients. So in this study for a French group, they found three criteria, and so it was an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest not witnessed by emergency medical services, a non-shockable initial rhythm, and a no spontaneous return of circulation before the third dose of adrenaline, or third milligram of adrenaline. And with those three criteria, they have 0% of survival in the first cohort. They validate that result with a second cohort. It was validated also with the present study cohort. Present study was a study with the presence of family during cardiopulmonary resuscitation. So, and at the end, they validate also the cohort with a Seattle cohort, so in King County. So, and in all of those patients with those three criteria, they only have one survivor. So for which patient we probably should not do it, so asystole or PEA, and not EMS witness cardiac arrest and no ROSC, that can be a good point. The presence of comorbidity, obvious mortal injury or irreversible death, valid and relevant advance directive available, and other strong evidence that further CPR will be against patient value or is considered futile. This is in the guideline for termination rule, so that's... as you can see, there is a big gap between we should probably do it and we probably should not do it. And for this patient, the evidence is lacking, and we don't know when to stop for that kind of patient. Should we perform prolonged CPR without eCPR available? There are some case reports about hypothermia, about refractory VF, and in this meta-analysis comparing eCPR to conventional CPR for refractory cardiac arrest, they showed that eCPR is doing better, but they still have some patients surviving in the group with conventional CPR, so probably some patients could survive with conventional CPR, but most of the time when you perform prolonged CPR, it's to go to eCPR, so that's... So this is a French guideline for indication for the use of extracorporeal life support. It was from 2009. It's almost the same criteria I described. So possible indication for intoxication, hypothermia, sign of life during CPR. There is some uncertainty, so refractory cardiac arrest with a short no-flow duration, a short low-flow duration, and a VFVT. And there is no indication if there is comorbidities, more than 5 minutes of no flow, and in case of asystole or PEA. And the anti-ideal CO2 also can be helpful for the determination. It is also possible to perform prolonged CPR for organ donation. So this is a review from international practice about organ donation. So there is some variation, but the protocol is usually very strict. The no flow is a maximum between 15 and 30 minutes. In France, there are strict criteria with below 55 years old, no diabetes, no hypertension, no sepsis, no cancer, no trauma. And the CPR duration until cannulation must be between 90 to 120 minutes, depending on the studies. So to conclude, we should do it for accidental hypothermia, especially in case of rescue collapse. Even if the hospital is very far, that's for rescue collapse, you should perform a prolonged CPR. If there is sign of life during CPR, we should probably do it for refractory VF or VT, for recurrent cardiac arrest, and if there are favorable prognosis factors at admission, like lactate, pH, anti-ideal CO2, and short low flow duration. And we need for some new monitoring parameter to assess brain viability when we fail to restore spontaneous circulation with conventional therapy. So that's a very important point, and we are waiting for that. Thank you very much.